Right. Coffee drinkers, what's happening? Going for a bit of a midweek-ish episode. Do not adjust your TV sets. That noise is intentional. Got a ring mod programmed in the HX Stomp. And I'm just working on a slightly different sound. I'm trying to change keys. All right, before we go any further, this podcast is not sponsored by Manscaped or the Cash App or ZipRecruiter or any of those things. But I will take this few seconds and sponsor it by one of my own things. Take this moment just to let you know about the brand new book, From Practice to Performance. I've got a pair of scissors sitting on the book right now on my desk. I just moved the scissors to read the title of my own fucking book. Okay. From Practice to Performance. It just came out less than a week ago. So let's just say that this episode of the podcast is sponsored by said book, Practice to Performance, Jazz Vocabulary for Electric Bass. It's the second book in the series of Jazz Vocabulary for Electric Bass. Moving on from 251, the previous, the opening book in that series. And I've had some amazing response. So if you did get the book already, thank you very much for that. I've had some really, really cool comments about it and people digging into it. Lots of questions on the stream, on the Twitch stream about it. Been doing Q&As about that book and all the books, actually. If you want it in the physical copy, as is sitting, physical form rather, as it, you can hear it, isn't that? It's a pretty meaty book as well. It's like 230 pages. If you want it in the physical form, as it sits here on my desk, you can get that at Amazon.com. I always say Jeff Bezos takes 40% of every sale, which is kind of a bummer when you look at it in the numbers. They do print everything and ship it and deal with the customer service, so I can't begrudge them that. But if you want it right this second, you go to JanekGwizdala.com and pick up the book, the ebook. Regardless of how you get it, really important, regardless of how you get it, physical or digital, both versions come with, I think this one is 60 videos and 30 play-alongs. They all come with supplementary material, and that's always a big question. Hey, if I get the physical book, do I still get the supplementary material? Absolutely. The videos and the play-alongs, of which there are plenty, all the details for that are inside the book. Just open a book, read inside the front cover. Don't send us emails about, man, how do you get the play-alongs? All the information's right there in the book. All right, let's get on with the show. Just working on changing keys, key centers, tonalities. And sounds as well. I'm working on everything, actually. Delay pedal, Mattoverse Electronics Swell Delay. Really cool pedal. Has like an expression button built into the pedal, and you can really swell into delays there. Super fun. Really digging that. Also, since the last episode, I got The Dark World by Chase Bliss. Not that this podcast is all going to be about pedals, but that's just updating you on what's going on my pedal board. The Dark World from Chase Bliss. Beautiful sounding. Actually, let's get rid of the ring mod so you can just hear the... So you can hear the sounds. What's up, babe? Hello. What's up? I'm not streaming. I'm recording a podcast.
Oh, sorry.
No, not sorry at all. Just, hello.
Hi, podcast.
Yeah. Chelsea's here. Oh, I love this. I'm smiling like so much more, even more than when I put the reverb headline. Hey, babe.
Hi.
I was thinking, hello. You should visit me more often when I'm recording podcasts.
Oh, my God.
I was thinking that we should just sit around a mic like this and do two bass hit.
I would love that.
You know, so we don't have to be camera ready. And
but also, if when we're on camera, we're a lot more conscious of not saying things that we shouldn't say on camera.
That's why I love the audio podcast, because I'm just fuck.
I feel like we would spill a lot of beans, as you say.
Yeah? You say spill the tea.
Yeah, because that's drama. Beans is a secret. We've been over this.
Oh.
Beans, secret, tea, drama.
I got to turn up the mic here. Go on. Because you're a low talker.
I know.
Anyone who's a Seinfeld fan, I think there's a low talker episode on Seinfeld. But, okay, you play. Go ahead.
No. Go. I was playing with you.
Oh. So Chelsea's doing the left hand. This gets very awkward.
No, like you take the top strings and I take the bottom two.
Okay, what tune do you want to play?
I know. One that I can play on two strings. Oh, this sucks. I can't. No.
Come on. F. First fret.
I know.
One, two, one, two.
I.
That was pretty good. It was good for the first two bars. Hey, did you want something? You're just all done with your meetings?
Yeah.
Beautiful. All right. I'll see
I'm
you.
Not done, though. I have to go back up. I was just seeing where you were.
Yeah, I'm right here. All right. So that's that happens. And I'm very grateful for that. That Chelsea pops in and sees me in the studio. But let's. Totally lost my focus now. In a good way. In a very good way. But this man, this Dark World. Having said I'm not going to talk about pedals, this Dark World from Chase Bliss might be one of the best pedals I've ever owned. Such a lush. Woo! Yes, Surrey Bob. Whoever Bob is. Anyway, let's get back to what's going on here. Rid of the reverb, changing keys. I should also grab some of your comments. I should have encouraged you guys and girls of the bass world to write in. I am posting this stuff to YouTube, so if you are watching on YouTube, leave a comment below the video if you want me to talk about something specific on the podcast. There were a bunch of comments, a bunch of people chimed in. A lot of people didn't like the potty mouth. Whoa! Okay. F. Elgar, I used to listen to your podcast when on the train heading into college. Back in the day, that's right, 2006, 2007, beginning of the podcast. Sarah Lloyd-Jones, Janek, a lovely sound on the front pickup. Is that your series 4? I don't know, actually. I'm crap with the series numbers of the Matheson basses. I don't know enough about them to say, like, oh, this is the series 4, Mark 2, or whatever. This is the bass that Anders built for me, so... yeah, that's what this is. Jonathan Oakey can definitely hear the Bill Burr influence. Whoa, come on! Yeah, I had to literally turn the microphone away to do the Bill Burr thing there. I love Bill Burr. He's so fucking opinionated and doesn't give a shit, which is, I think, how it should be. Also, maybe I should get this up on a stand. Would that really help? Here we go, super ghetto mic stand here, and I'm going to put it slightly up. How about that?
How about that?
Camoso, I hate this stupid pandemic. Don't we all? Great content as always. What pedal makes those glitchy repeating sounds? That's probably always the Maris Otto Bit Jr. Paul Baker says you've got a lot of good things to say. Sometimes, with a following wind and tide, I can throw a few things out there. Jay Serrano, Phuket Blues or Fuck It Blues. Yeah, pretty much. That was Wendy Watkins says, love your stuff, but clearly not in a great mood when you recorded this. Never heard you swear so much in the first fucking 5 minutes of any of your... She didn't swear. You're better than that, Janek. Interesting. Well, oh, shit. And then people... Wow, people went in on Wendy. I don't know if Wendy deserved this, but okay. Not a person who was butthurt by a word, but not about his own government taking our rights and making us sick by swearing. By Jesus Christ. Making us sick by wearing a stupid mask. Daniel Page, get your head out of your fucking ass. Not cool. Government making us sick by wearing a mask. You are so upside down on science, my friend. Wow. Maybe I shouldn't maybe I should take my own advice and not read the fucking comments, because although some of them are very nice, and for the most part, you guys are very cool, I will actually... I wasn't... Wendy said I clearly wasn't in a good mood. I don't know if I wasn't in a good mood. I think I was just ready to not be polished, you know, and not be all like... I'm never scripted, but, you know, never be... I was ready not to be censored, I think. So it wasn't my mood. I think it was just me. Maybe the ugly truth showed itself, but Jesus Christ. Let's not fucking talk about masks, please. Because if you are anti-masker, anti-vaxxer, I have fucking zero time for you. Yeah, so I really shouldn't actually do that. I should have a different place for you guys to ask questions. Shit, now you just throw me for a loop. Okay, let's get back to what I was doing, which was practicing. I don't know why I thought it was a good idea to start recording a podcast while I was in the middle of practicing. I thought because I wanted to just share this, share what I was doing with people. Now I get super distracted. 100% my fault. 100% my fault. Not blaming anyone else for that. So, let's see. And I want to, like... get away from the clean sound. That's why I've got the ring mod on. And I'm working on how different settings on the bass affect that. So right now, both pickups and active mode. Now, front pickup and passive mode. I think I prefer the active mode for this effect. It's weird. It goes back and forth. You know, it's some things work great passive, some things work great active. And with this effect on, not so much of a change in the sound, more about the feel that I'm getting through my fingers, the response from the instrument. Working on changing key centers. Working on some quartal voicings, those are always good for that. Ah. And not going with the obvious, like cycle of fourths or almost picking a melody note at random and turning that into some part of a five chord to get to the next one. So if I'm here in B flat, to get from B flat to D minor, B flat minor to D minor, for instance. So just minor chords in major thirds. So sort of minor third of B flat minor becomes the major third of A7 or G diminished, E diminished, B flat diminished. To get to D minor. I guess we could carry on in that vein, right? But instead of moving a major third in the tonality, use the same melody note. Did I use the same melody note? Yeah, I used the minor third of the key, so D minor now. Use the minor third of the key. Same kind of five shape, or diminished shape, but to go a half step away. So to get to E flat minor, so from D minor to E flat minor. Now say I wanted to get to, now move a major third away, minor third of the root, minor third of the tone, key center, and we get from E flat minor to G minor. The ring mod for now. Man, I like this delay. Holy shit, just as a regular delay without the noise. It has a noise feature and the swell and all that stuff. It's just a nice delay. Oh, definitely need to sneeze. Oh, la 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 la. Boom. Ooh, la, la. So, so great. You can get so many different places just with that one key element, just heading for the minor third of the key you're in, G minor. B flat is the minor third, becomes your melody. You have all of these places to go now. So I could go up, down a whole step, so from G minor to F minor. So that's down a whole step, where else? Up a fifth, down a fourth. Up a minor third, so G minor to B flat. No. What am I talking about? No, I went rhythm. So G minor to D. G minor to F. Be a bit janky. G minor to B minor. So many nice ways of moving around key centers. work on the one finger thing. I have a Risha here for the first time. This oud pick. Now, I know that I get lots of comments about the noise I make with my mouth. I said this in the last episode. All that shit. The whole suck it up and deal with it because that's just what I do. Okay, yes, that is true. It's also a very unrealistic situation that we find ourselves in here with my mouth, you know, 12 inches from a microphone. That doesn't happen in any sort of live performance situation. You also don't get to hear, you know, if I turn the bass off, for instance, you're getting all that fret noise and finger noise because the bass is also so close to the mic. So please bear that in mind before you go jumping in the comments about how unbearable the extra curricular sound is that's coming into the mic. Still can't play with that pick. Because it's a very unrealistic situation. And I'm trying to do it in the most efficient way possible in terms of just recording the podcast. Getting what's in my brain out there and then moving the fuck along to get onto other stuff. Brother-in-law just went live on Twitch, so I am gonna make sure I'm on there. If you want to follow some crazy Pokemon runs, then highly suggest following OatBoy1, OatBoy1 on Twitch. Whew. He's a world-class oboe player. That's Chelsea's brother, but he's also pretty badass with Pokemon, I guess. And is a recently newly minted streamer. So yeah, check him out. Can't do that with the reverb one. I'm gonna have him on in the background here. This is one from the new book. Want to get comfortable with melodic minor? This is a great one. Ooh, all keys as well. Ooh. Ah, come on, gotta get the 9. There we go. It's really good for the details of moving through a tonality or a sound diatonically. It's a pattern of 5, so it's the arpeggio. If we do it in the root position, it's an arpeggio, which in melodic minor, the 1 is a major minor. So major 7, 5, minor 3, 1, and then I'm popping up to the 9. So it ends up being a 5-note phrase. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Actually, good just to cycle that. But then to be able to move sequentially through the melodic minor scale, maintaining that shape, but diatonically to the sound. ending on there is a nice way to end the exercise, but actually good to do it maybe four times on each scale degree. Practice actually. I'm going to take the watch off. That's a little heavy on the left wrist. Oh, it's like taking a weight vest off or something and suddenly being free. It's good to just be able to, you know, you shouldn't just practice that stuff in sequential order. Practice it out of sequence. Like for every single melody note, you should know exactly where that shape falls underneath it. So if you go to the 11 or the 4, you should know that that's the shape. Or the natural 6. The root is the melody. 9. Just be really in control of it. So you then, I think you become really free in terms of knowing. Not only do you know the sound, and that's that sound of melodic minor is really sort of ingrained in the brain, but then you get to, it doesn't have to be this shape of 5, for instance. You just get to be so loose and so in control of that sound when you come to improvise. I think that's a big key to a performance being kind of honest. As long as you're not just reciting patterns. You're like, oh, it's C, it's C, it's C. Okay, so I'm going to run this up and down and, you know, cool. No, just a bit. Thinking about it now too much. I'm trying not to play the pattern specifically to illustrate my point. I don't normally get into that headspace. I'm not sure who I heard playing that. Might have been like Rick Margitsa or Brecker or someone like that. I know I heard that from someone and just kind of, you know, that's the whole point of the book actually, From Practice to Performance. That's what it's about. It's about hearing someone great do that, someone I really admire, or you hearing someone you really admire play something and then knowing how to just take that little piece of information, that tiny phrase, and put it into some sort of routine to improve your fluidity and to populate your practice routine. You know, there's some days you really want to practice, but you're not sure what to practice. Those can be a bummer. So with this, with the kind of concepts that are in the new book, that's exactly what it's designed for. So you sort of never run out of ideas. My entire thing, I guess, is like never running out of ideas. How can you possibly level up every single time you sit down with the instrument and give yourself a challenge that is a challenge, but is also not completely out of reach as well. Like, have that good balance. That's what I'm always looking for. And then of course you get the happy accidents sometimes. Let's put something in the looper, maybe. Uh, See, I've really got to get used to the swell delay, to not hold it down the whole time, because it just increases in volume. I definitely got to work on that. That is that'll be some me time. not necessarily going to subject you guys to that process. Whoa, man. Something I got from a gypsy guitar, like French Manouche kind of line. Maybe. Man, I used to do this a lot. Not so much lately, huh? Turn off that reverb. I overcooked the tempo on this because I haven't done this in a long time. Do those endings. Come on, faking it. Damn it. I was running out of real estate.
That's a shitty excuse.
Shitty excuse! I'm kind of bullshitting a little bit there. It's funny. It's not funny. It's fucking really frustrating to play too much of the same shit over and over and over. Interessant. It's like when stuff is going by at a kind of a bit of a lick. I mean, that's not high tempo. That's yeah, it's kind of medium-ish, medium up maybe. It's not crazy tempo, but need better ideas. I think need better ideas and maybe a different approach. That was just gratuitous. Maybe we put that one to bed for today. Yes indeed, I think we do. Actually, maybe we put the whole podcast to bed for today, make it digestible. Not too much. Alright, that's it, a little short and sweet, not so ranty. Yeah, let's get back, maybe come back on, so what's the day, Thursday? Maybe Thursday and Sunday's are good days for this. Let me know. Hit me up on, I said I was going to try and not look at the comments on YouTube because that sent me into a rage. Might have thrown the computer through the window. Not healthy. Anyway, either way, I'm sure you'll find a way to make yourself heard if you feel what you have to say is worth hearing. So on that sentiment, let's call it a day. I'll see you on the next one, Cass.